You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV. Television addict! Television addict!
Television addict! Good morning, everybody. Good evening, good afternoon. It is Ken Reed here, your TV guidance counselor on the show. TV guidance counselor, appropriately. If you hear some odd breathing and sort of licking sounds in the background, fear not. It is simply Larry, my puppy, who is desperately trying to eat a Band-Aid off my finger. So it's just disgusting, not sexual in any way. And that's really our motto here on the show. But let's move on. My guest this week is the incredibly funny comedian Brooke Van Poppelen. Brooke is someone who I've known for years through stand-up and just keeps doing better and better every year. You may know her best from TruTV's Hack My Life. But she's incredibly funny, super smart, loved talking to her. I didn't know that she shared such a similarly odd childhood as I do. Not exactly the same, but definitely in the same key, let's say. Brooke is great. I love talking to her. I think you'll really enjoy hearing me talk to her. And if you enjoy it so much that you would like to reward me in some way other than just by your listening, you can donate to our Patreon. It is patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. You can do $1, you can do $1 million, whatever you want. If you would like to do it, but you don't see any rewards there that you would like, email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com. Let me know what you'd like to see as a reward, and I will see if I can do that, because I am a complete novice and idiot with this sort of thing, and I'm very bad at self-promotion. So any ideas you have are very warranted. Anyway, here is this week's episode. So please enjoy. You should sit back, relax, and then enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Brooke Van Poppelen.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Brooke Van Poppelen, how are you?
Hi, so good. I'm glad this worked out.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the last time I saw you was in Brooklyn.
Probably.
And it was like cold and gross.
Stop, you're triggering
now we're
me. Now we're on a ranch.
Yeah, I know.
Betty Davis
we're
is
in a
ranch.
We're in a ranch house, and there's horses and things, and it's nice.
And yeah. this is the life I chose
yes.
over Brooklyn.
So. You were there for a while, right? Weren't you?
I was in Brooklyn for 10 years. I got out just under the 10-year mark because that was my pledge to myself.
Right.
Is I was like, I yes. refuse to make it a full 10 years.
Yes, don't want to say a decade.
Exactly, because there's a rumor that floats around that I'm not sure where it started, but if you go past 10 years, like, there's no going back.
Yes, it's like being on a soap opera.
Exactly. Like, it's just sort of like you're done. You're now a broken, weird New Yorker forever, and you will forget how the rest of the world functions.
Yes.
So if you can get out before 10 years, then you've got a running chance.
Right.
Yeah, you had a sporting chance of not being a weirdo and living somewhere else.
That's so Grimm's fairy tale. That's like a weird Rumpelstiltskin rule. Like, you have 10 years to get out.
Well, I was like, I had the opposite of agoraphobia after leaving New York, where the open spaces of just land and canyons and farmland and countryside and driving, even specifically from Los Angeles to San Francisco, which are just vast expanses along the 5 freeway, was giving me panic attacks that there wasn't like a gas station in sight. So I was not being treated for panic and anxiety at the time either, but I didn't know that, like, oh, this is now a new fear,
right?
Which is I think it definitely has a descriptor, but it's like the opposite of agoraphobia.
Well, agoraphobia is outside, right?
Claustrophobia is like more like small spaces. Agoraphobia is kind of not wanting to leave the house.
Right. So it's like an expanded
It's almost like I'm freaked out by the expanseness.
Right.
The vastness of whatever after living in such a quote-unquote claustrophobic city that made you want to be agoraphobic.
But where everything was accessible. Like,
well, right. If you needed anything.
Yeah.
So it was like...
It's like living in a cell phone.
It was crazy, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that was the thing, when I used to have panic attacks you would have one and then you would have them about having them. So yes. That's what it's like when you're like, there's no bathroom around here. There's nothing. I will like start puking or something, you know, right. Like whatever. Like, and you freak out.
You become very like, and we're not going to make this about the panic hour
right.
Or whatever. But yeah, it was funny to be like, oh, as much as New York's making me crazy.
Yeah.
I know that there are people around me at all times in case I pop off.
Even though they won't care.
They won't care. They'll step over me.
Yeah. But there's a better chance that someone might be like, I'm a nurse.
Exactly.
Something. Yeah.
And then it's like just me and my rescue dog at that time. Yes, and I was like, no one for miles.
Yes.
And
but you had a giant St. Bernard who always had a barrel of brandy around his
yes,
neck.
Exactly.
Whenever, yeah. Whenever I see someone with a comfort dog or like a rescue dog, I really want them to go all in and have a St. Bernard with a little barrel around its neck.
Yeah, like more of some refreshing brandy.
Yes. Because I'm like,
to snap you out of your stupor.
Let's just do it. Yeah. Excuse me. Because you grew up in like the suburbs like north of Detroit, right?
Yeah.
Like, but were you going into the city a lot, or were you pretty suburban?
When I was young, so like as a family, like yeah, we would actively go to Tigers games. We'd go to like Eastern Market. We would
Cobo Hall.
Yeah, Cobo Hall, Greek Town, museums. I mean, like I had so much fun talking about Belle Isle with a bunch of old, buddies from Michigan who were like, there was like Belle Isle and then like Bablo Island, which Bablo Island, which is like you would always do whatever school you went to. It was usually grade school, not high school, a big field trip out there. Other schools would be going on the same day, and it'd be like a weird like dance party on this old ferry boat.
Weird.
Like it's just so strange. And I guess the Bablo Island ferry completely caught on fire a year ago.
Wonderful. The Bablo Island fire.
The great Bablo Island fire of, I think it was just in 2018 recently.
Jeez, did anyone die?
I don't think so. And it was Alyssa Slotkin who we were talking about Bablo Island. She's like, that boat caught on fire or whatever.
It's a hell of a dance party. It must have been tearing up the dance floor.
I know, yeah. Right? I mean, I think it's been shut down for a long time, probably for a lot of safety reasons.
I'm sure. You don't want to get a bunch of children out on a boat. generally, that's frowned upon.
Proclivity for catching fire.
I pitched a show once to – it was our local PBS, WGBH PBS in Boston that was trying to do like podcasts. And a show I pitched to them was – I was going to call Permission Slip. And it was going to be – because they wanted like an interview show but not like a normal one.
Right.
So I was like, we'll go on like – I learned that kids don't really go on field trips anymore. Because of liability. So they don't go to like, we used to go to like the peanut butter factory tour.
Anything.
And like,
you can't do that anymore.
Which you can't do anymore.
No.
But I was like, I bet though, if you were doing a show, you could get them to let you do that. Because like Food Network's always going to factories and showing you that everything's made by putting it in a big tumbler that just spins, no matter what it is. That's everything.
Yeah.
So I'm like, you could probably do that and then set it up like, if their parents are alive, make them sign a permission slip for something and then like do the interview like as you do the thing.
Yeah, like we had field trips where like in eighth grade we got on a plane and flew to Chicago from the Detroit airport.
For like the day?
And we did a day and did museums and flew back that night.
Yeah. Kids used to do that at D.C. from Boston.
Yeah.
So it's like an hour flight.
I mean, don't get me wrong. We were like, we're getting on a plane. This is wild. That's like next level field trip.
Oh, yeah. You're crossing state lines.
Mm-hmm.
We would go to like farms. We would go to, we went to the Topsfield Fair, which was like the state fair in Massachusetts. And I remember this kid, Weston Spots, got kicked out. He snuck into a tent that had the biggest horse in the world, Big Red. And it was just, because it was, when we would go, it was still like that transitional period where like old carny stuff was still there.
Well, yeah.
They had a freak show.
Yeah.
And this it was just a big horse, but they had like a wax cylindery vinyl thing that told you about the horse that you walked in and it was just playing and there was a big horse, but it was skipping and the guy who ran it didn't care. So you literally walked in and it was just like, it's Big Red. It's Big Red.
And little do they know, it's driving the actual horse insane. And he snaps and he
killed Weston Spots. Weston like snuck in under the tent and this guy walked in and slapped him and then just threw him out of the tent. And the teachers were like, hey, don't do that.
Hey, these are the good old days when strangers could slap students in a carny tent and nobody cared.
They deserved it.
Oh my God. We were made to go in third grade because what you saying this, I'm like, this was my most hated field trip. So we'd have to go to Stony Creek, the old original school. This was like a third or fourth grade thing. I forget, but it was part of where I went to school and everyone knew. They would dress you up. I had to be sent out the door in old-timey clothes and a bonnet. And we went to a one-room schoolhouse for a whole week.
And this is a public school you went to?
Well, I went to private school through eighth grade.
Okay.
And so this old one-room schoolhouse where we did all of our learning for the week on
chalkboards
and tablets. We all had our own our own little chalkboard. We would do math. Our teacher was wearing like a bonnet and a floor-length, you know, prairie dress. We churned butter. We fed
cows. For a whole week?
For a whole fucking week.
Jesus Christ.
I was like, and we would have to be like, I was like, come on. I mean, you know, when your parents both work and they're like, I have to put together a lunch for my kid in a fucking bucket wrapped in some cloth napkins.
They even made them have, you had to be that like, our parents, authentic.
Yeah. You know, and of course they're always like, it's so much to ask of a parent now that I'm looking back at this. Yeah. But then as a kid, when you're like, huh, stupid David with his like raised by his white trash grandpa showing up with, right? Like, and then you're like, it is so much to ask of any parent to do this for this like stupid adventure that I brought nothing away from other than like, I'm totally fine with my Nintendo and you know
you I appreciate would, not having to churn butter
and you know, the outhouse situation the whole thing
you'd use an outhouse
we had to use an outhouse it was hot as hell
Jesus
like,
Christ
it was I was just like no thanks
it'd be extra wonderful as a comedian if they did it the style of like I don't know if anyone ever actually did this in school but they did it on TV all the time where you got like had to pretend to be married to someone and do a budget and like and then they'd pull things out of a hat and be like you're getting divorced you're having a baby and you had to like factor that in if they did that and was like you have dysentery
right, Oregon Trail like actual Oregon Trail
you have a gangrenous leg you have to deal with it all week now
uh-oh you guys are the Donner family
you've been accused of witchcraft which would be wonderful. We didn't do anything like that.
Sorry about my smoker cough.
It's quite all right.
No, it's just the tail end of a cold that's making me feel like I have smoker's lungs.
And the pack of cigarettes that you're smoking right now.
Yeah,
she came in with a pack of Winston's.
Well, I feel like I should just be in character. If I'm going to have a cough like this, I should just have them tucked into my front pocket.
Rolled up in the sleeve.
Exactly.
She had a switchblade. She was really all
she
in.
She was combing her hair.
I miss field trips, though. They were a fun time. And I imagine out here, like, kids would go to, like, movie sets and things.
Oh, it would have been so amazing. Or just the idea, too, that, like, I mean, the zoos out here are world class.
Yeah.
All of the aquariums, you know, all that stuff. But
the best thing we did was...
It's like, we're going to the Sharon Tate house.
Yes, we're going to the Tate murder house, the LaBianca murder house. Parker Brothers, the board game company, based in Salem, Mass. Mm-hmm. And we would go there. We'd go to the factory. And it was the closest thing I've ever had to, like, go into, like, Willy Wonka. Because they're making, like, all the board games.
Wow.
That was cool.
I would go see that now.
Yeah. But they move... I don't know. They're not there anymore. It's like condos where the factory was. Mm-hmm. But then the only good thing of my childhood... was we got to go once a month and we'd test new games mm-hmm. in like a two-way mirror situation. And they'd give you a check for $50 and we're like 10. And then you play the game for an hour and then you tell them about it. And none of the games we played ever came out. They were all horrible games.
It turns out they were all kind of like weird and racist and misogynistic.
Yes. One was called Who's the Black Guy? And then it was kind of like Hot Potato.
Yeah.
But it was very, very strange. But I don't know what kids do now. I guess they do virtual field trips.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Or they have like really nice computer facilities.
Yes.
So they're probably learning at a rate 10 times faster than
skill sets. Not churning butter. Probably not allowed to have butter in the school.
No, definitely not.
For butter allergies, which I don't think is a thing.
Unless the children are on bulletproof coffee.
That's true.
Kicks, which apparently is really great for your metabolism. So
what is bulletproof coffee?
Oh my God. It's literally like people, you blend together ghee, butter, and usually like little coconut oil, and then cold brew.
Okay.
And it sustains you, apparently, with energy and protein in your stomach.
Okay.
It sounds like madness to me.
Yeah. Like, kids don't generally need more energy.
I know, right? But I was just thinking that, like, it's like, that's an acceptable time to have butter.
Butter's okay then, because now it's homeopathic. So September 3rd through the 9th here, 1988 is what you went for. And you gravitated to this immediately because it had the Olympics and gymnastics on the cover.
Absolutely.
But as you sort of looked at the cover more, you're like, oh, and there's Miss America, who is from Michigan.
Michigan,
it's
right?
kind of gotten more and more. And then Platoon was on, and you, of course, fought in Vietnam.
I fought in Vietnam. But I was definitely raised on Peanuts. Like, my grandparents had every single Charles Schulz book, and so that was, it's just like a very, very strong affinity for, you know, the cartoon, the books, all the little specials, you know.
But they're great. They're so existentially crisis-y.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they're sweet, and they're, you learn from them.
Absolutely. Yeah, because me, like, don't get me wrong, loved watching, like, some gummy bears and stuff like that.
Dashing and daring, courageous and caring. Yeah.
You know, but I was like, I'm always a little more glass half empty person, so, like, Charlie Brown and Lucy, those were my people.
Yeah.
You know?
And it was so unusual.
What? I was like, thank you. The world is kind of shit.
Sometimes things don't work out.
Exactly.
We don't always get the gummy berry juice to get us out of every situation. Yeah, that show, sometimes I would be turned off by it because it was like a little too like 70s dystopian sometimes as a kid. Like, I'd be tempted to be like, oh, you just really kind of bummed me out too much.
No, there wasn't like a real uplifting takeaway on a certain episode.
No, life is disappointment, everybody. Yep. It was like watching Babe Pig in the City, which was about a movie about how the world doesn't care about you. and it's fantastic for being so. So, yeah, and then did you used to do gymnastics?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was a gymnast. It's funny. I don't remember and give myself any credit or credence. It's like, oh yeah, like I definitely I competed for a while. I didn't go that far into it because I feel like I started later, so they didn't have a chance to stunt my growth.
To ruin your development.
Exactly. Yeah. My spine wasn't crushed at the proper age.
You were over 5 feet tall.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, I'm 5'6", so it would have been a total disaster. But I'd started late, and I think just ultimately, too, I was like, I'm interested in so many other things.
Because
there's a moment where they kind of draw a line in the sand, like, are you going to be a gymnast?
This is your life.
And, but yeah, I mean, like, I was at a point which blows my mind that I could do, like, a back handspring on a balance beam.
Wow.
Which, like, to me, that's not just doing some somersaults.
No.
Like, I got to a point where I was really good on, you know, uneven bars, and
that's like superhero skills.
Yeah, it was really cool. And so, like, especially after a few drinks these days, I love to, like, because I live really close to a playground in Glendale, and I remember I was like, check this out, because whenever I see a bar that's low enough, I have like one or two kind of cool tricks still at my sleeve, but if it's too high, I have no upper body strength anymore. So I just kind of hang there, and I'm like,
"This is part of it."
Never mind.
And then,
like, as I just hear my muscles ripping in my atrophied arms, I'm just like, "Oh,
help me!" Well, we had like America had a really weird fascination with gymnastics.
Well, the Nadia Comaneci, Nadia Comaneci story, like that movie that came out after she scored the perfect 10. And I mean, like, that was my religion. I would sit so close to the TV. Like, you knew you loved something when your, like, face was literally up in the TV. And I would weep when I watched it because I was like, I think this is who I am.
It's
and
me.
Then, yeah, exactly.
But anyway, I guess it was the first time. And there was also a Mary Lou Retton who had her own kids exercise show on Saturday mornings show up and guest star and everything. And then there would be Nadia Comaneci like surrogates in the plot of things. Like, there'd be a MacGyver episode where, like, a Russian gymnast is defecting and he needs to help her. Like, it was just everywhere, to the point where Mr. T's cartoon was about him coaching a team of gymnasts.
Yeah, so I've got those old stickers still.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, and I was just like, this is my jam. Mr. T and a team of Olympic gymnasts?
Yeah.
Like, hell yeah. And
perfect.
I had crushes, like, on all of the cartoons.
We all did.
Oh,
Phil Lamar was one of those voices, if you know.
Really?
Phil. Yeah.
Okay.
But I think it was the first job he did. But it was also the first sport I remember that was predominantly female. Mm-hmm. Like, it was girls doing it. Mm-hmm. And people were like, this is cool. Like, they weren't like, oh, it's women's basketball. Right. Or, you know, and it wasn't like a different version of another sport.
Right. Which and was cool. I think just because, you know, like anytime you watch the Olympics, it's like, you're, you know, or even World Cup, because it's happening like every 4 years, essentially, you're like, you're in it for the stories. Yeah. You know, they twist their ankle and they're fucked. Like, their career's over. This was their last Olympics because they're 13 now. They've aged out.
After retire. Yeah.
Whatever. But, and I just think there are so many extraordinary stories with the young women that, like, they were absolutely put on the national stage in a way, like, in 1988 that captivated me. And I think it, like, yeah, it's like, it's, I feel like then everyone got way crazy about ice skating a few years after that.
Yeah, which, but I think was partly because of the Nancy Kerrigan thing. Uh-huh, but for non-ice skating reasons.
I'm like, I see that mosquito.
There's a mosquito in here. We're going through a California mosquito plague, as Brooke informed us of. Oh, there we go. I think he got it.
You didn't get it?
Almost. You made him angry. Yeah, where there's like basically the killer bee, mosquito version of killer bees have invaded California.
It's something, because we are so spoiled out here. You're always like, guess who doesn't, like, because you leave your windows and your doors open.
Yeah, of course.
The worst that comes in is like flies, crickets,
or a murderer.
Serial killers are everywhere in California. But now the mosquito thing is
it's really weird. Yeah, but I think it seems to have gone. It's probably draining my wife of all her blood.
It's hiding and scheming in that. It was they like to hide under the bed, so just
They're like boogeymen.
They're like boogeymen. That's where they gather their strength during the day and then come out and bleed and you at
feed
night.
Feed on you at night. Sleep well, children. The thing about the Olympics too is, and it might just be that I'm older and I don't care anymore, or partly because there's not three networks now. But like 88, 92, they were massive events in that. Everybody was watching it. Everybody knew about it. But I remember it sort of seeping into everything else. Like McDonald's had like an Olympics promotion. And, you know, it was all the popular culture was seeped in Olympics, which I don't feel like happens now.
But that's, I mean, and that just harkens back to the idea that, you know, even in the late 80s, TV had less to choose from. Mm. So they were singular events that we would experience as a country and as a whole. You're like, no, everyone is watching the Olympics right now.
Yeah.
You know, and on one network hosting it, you know, you don't have all your different, I mean, I think usually it's like NBC or whoever is like the official network of stuff like that. But, I just feel like it's those moments when you're like, no, this is when America, like, it's just what you knew. We were all going home to do that with our family or whatever, or it was going to be on, like, you know, not that I was drinking in 88, but it's like that was going
to
be.
We'll go to the bar and I'll watch it. Yeah.
Whatever, you know.
Which was interesting when, like, there are a few shows that have done that where you have to kind of watch day and date. Like, I think people were doing it for The Bachelor, or like even Mad Men and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But it's almost like a weird, quirky, like, throwback. Like, we're going to go to the drive-in. But it's like, we're all going to watch a show when it airs together.
Totally.
It's really weird. It's like, so we did.
I kind of think Game of Thrones right now is that's kind of it for appointment watching that I, you know, but the fact that they even took that break for a year, I'm like, oh, I don't care anymore.
Yeah.
Like,
you've lost me. You've lost me.
We'll see if I tune in. I have to wait a whole nother year. It's been a year.
I used to wait 4 years for the Olympics, but now my tolerance, zilch. Yes. So, and also, was it a big deal that Miss America 1988 was from Michigan?
Well, I'm not, like, I just happened, I was like, oh, Michigan.
Yeah. Because she has the sash on, everybody.
I remember no specifics about her, so I actually kind of want to go look her up and see if, you know, she had, like, classic Michigan values, because I'm curious, like, was she from the Detroit area? Was she like a northern Michigan or a west side? Because, like, there's a lot of different types of Michigan people.
You have the UP. Is that the real rural frozen?
We don't let those hobgoblins down into the mainland.
The ice.
They're Wisconsinites, pretty much.
Ice Yetis is what we call them. They only eat fish they caught with their hands. Mm-hmm. Because I love Detroit. I used to work for a job that made me travel a lot, and like everyone wanted to take like the Orlando convention, and I'm like, nope,
Motor City.
Yeah,
please.
I'm like, I'll go to Detroit, and like I'd get like the penthouse at the Renaissance Center because it was like $40. It was just like, it was amazing, and I'm like, this town has a lot of character. I'm going to the Motown Museum or like whatever.
The Motown Museum.
Oh, it's amazing.
It's the best $20 you can spend. when you are in Detroit, it is like the most you will ever get out of $20.
Yeah. It's oh, for sure.
Favorite thing.
And it seems to be coming backish now. Like, is your family still there?
Yeah. Oh, totally.
Yeah.
Last time I went was probably 2014, and now since then they've expanded a little bit, and now I think there's a permanent girl groups exhibit too,
that's cool.
Which is really awesome. But yeah, it's just so cool. You're just like wandering through Berry Gordy's two-story house.
Yeah, it's just there. And were you a Freaks and Geeks fan?
One, I can't even talk about it.
Yeah.
I literally, my point of view, I think my whole high school, I was a Lindsay Weir.
Yeah.
I was a good girl who was just attracted to, you know, kind of more artistic or cool kids, whatever.
Interesting people.
Interesting people, yeah. If you will. But I always had such a moral censor, and coming from a good family, my conscience would always get the better of me. I never really like smoked or participated in it, you know, but I was like, I like being around them. But I was absolutely sort of like just an imposter.
Because it's like a few years earlier, you're older than we are, but it's weird to see that in the exact city. Yeah.
Because that's more like in the Macomb County,
which is like a suburb of the other thing. Okay.
Area. Yes, it's very adjacent and really, really close to where I grew up in Rochester.
Like, okay.
Very good friends who are from that exact area. Where I think that's where Judd's from, right?
Right. Yeah.
And then I don't know if Paul Fike.
Paul's from there. Judd's from Long Island.
That's what I thought. Yeah, I was like, it's Paul. Yeah, which, by the way, I'm really excited. I have some projects
into
Paul Feig's company. So I'm like hoping at one point I can talk to him.
Michigan.
Michigan shop, you know.
But it's rare to see, unless you grew up in New York or L.A., and even then, it's rare to see a show about your youth set where you grew up, more or less. Like, that's really strange.
And that you're like, this is painfully, this is like a painfully accurate depiction, you know, of what a Midwest upbringing is like.
Which is never depicted. I mean, they will do like generic America, but they hardly ever like specifically set it in an actual city or near an actual city, which I think like Wonder Years was like
vaguely Midwest, where I'm like, I don't know if I can think of the town. Like, was it Indiana?
I don't know if they mentioned it.
And it was probably California, and
They literally filmed it half a mile from here. The Kevin Allison house is in Burbank. Which, once I realized it, ruined it a little bit for me, because now whenever I'm out here, I always try to hit up like one or two shooting locations of something. Mm-hmm. Like in Pasadena, I went to the My So-Called Life house and the Pretty in Pink house and stuff. But which is fun, but it makes me realize that they've shot it such a way that from the one angle where you can't see palm trees and the mountains.
It's exactly what I'm always thinking is like, what a bummer as the camera operator to literally have no creativity beyond
one shot.
Yeah. Your establishing shot of the exterior, and it's like, so help you God. You know, if like an exotic pelican, you know, comes flapping.
Some dude with a surfboard. You're like, why is he surfing?
It must have been California. But they made it feel really generic. I'm trying to think.
Well, they were talking about like car manufacturing a lot, and like his dad worked at like a car plant. Like, plus his dad seemed so not California to me. Like, there was always that kid whose like dad was angry all the time, and you were scared to go over to their house because they would never yell at you, but they would like yell at their kid in front of you.
Like, they could not muster a smile.
Yes,
that is absolutely like.
Nothing was worse than a friend getting yelled at by their parent, and their parent involved you in it. Like, I don't know if that ever happened, but they would be like, Andrew's stupid. Isn't he stupid, Kenny? And I'm like, I'm neutral here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Like, how do we get out of this alive?
Please don't do that. Yeah, it kind of ruins it. Like, John Marshall High School, which they use for Wonder Years and Grease and everything. Mm-hmm. It looks iconically America, but then it's literally surrounded by, like, Spanish-style bungalows. And it's really weird.
It does make you, like, think more about the idea of being, like, a location scout and how, like, you know, the parameters and learning how to be really good at that job.
Good job, everybody.
Right?
Yeah.
Well done.
You guys really nailed it.
I'm in Anywhere America.
So you wrote some stuff down there. What do we got? What's the first thing you had?
Well, I wrote some stuff down because I haven't looked in a TV guide in so long. I was like, I don't even know how to find the evening. And then I got it. But I initially was looking at the 4:30 to 6:30.
The after school slot?
Well, the after school slot, because so like in 1988, I was 10. So definitely a lot of getting home and immediately, like, I was just like, Turkey Television was the first thing. Oh, yes.
Nickelodeon's sketch comedy show.
Oh, my God. Yep. Loved me some Turkey Television.
I loved it because it was like irreverent, but also it was made by the people who made You Can't Do That on Television. Exactly. Actually, Christine McGlade from Moose from You Can't Do That on Television, they hired her as a writer, director, producer, and she was like 19.
I know.
So, which is amazing.
It's so cool.
And they'd show a lot of weird foreign stuff there, like Australian and English little shorts, and it just felt like it was one of those shows that felt like you were getting away with something watching it.
Yeah, where I was just like, Does anyone else see this?
Yeah.
Like,
this is just for us?
Wow.
I love that show.
Just bizarro. But it had that impact on me where I'm like, ooh, I'm like traveling outside of my bubble of, you know, living in the Midwest and or only watching shows that feel targeted toward me as a 10-year-old. Because you're like, ooh, this feels...
kind of adult.
Subversive.
It wasn't risque or anything, but it was just, it didn't.
It was just weird.
Yeah, it was just weird, and it wasn't like they were aiming at any audience.
Unapologetically weird.
Yes. The one that always, it was Norman Gunston they used to show, which was the Australian guy who always had the toilet paper shaving cuts on his face. I looked him up later because I couldn't remember. I was like, was that real? And it was a guy who had shows in the 70s in Australia that was kind of like L.E.G. basically.
Okay.
So he would do interviews with real people as this like complete idiot newscaster. And the look he always had for people was that he had cut himself shaving a bunch. So he had like blood soaked little piece of toilet paper all over his face, which was just such a weird choice to do. And that was always on Turkey Television. And what was the other guy? Uncle Floyd, who had a cable access show in I think New York. And but just bizarreness. And
really bizarre.
And I think for those of us who went into comedy later, like those shows, the kids who really like those shows ended up going like, this is something different.
Like, it's latch on to some of this weirdness. Because, yeah, like, I, you know, my dad would, like, he got me into, like, the Ghoul and, like, you know, weird, like, pirate radio sort of stuff like that, too. And, yeah, it just made me feel like I was like, oh, the world's bigger and weirder than I ever knew.
Well, were you getting Canadian stuff?
Yeah, that's just it. It's like, you know, even now, you know, we're laughing. Like, when you drive into Detroit, like, you have to turn your cell phone data off because you'll get hit with international fees. Like, you get that close to Canada.
Right.
You know, but, yeah, like, kind of Canadian culture is a huge – that's why I was going to say, I'm like, we loved Degrassi Junior High.
Yes.
You know, for sure, but we can get to that.
Oh, yeah. I will get to that in a moment, too. Yeah, because last time I was in Detroit, it was in winter, and I was like, you just run across Lake Michigan.
Totally.
Go to Canada. Like, it's right there.
It's,
It seems pretty solid. Go gamble. I love Turkey TV. Were you a latchkey kid, or were your parents home?
Like, latchkey's not the word, but we, just because my parents, probably at age 10, not latchkey, but we always had to go to what? I don't know if that was a nice word for it, but like the before and after school room is where we spent a lot of our time. And then we were also in the mornings dropped off at daycare at 6 a.m. usually. And then we'd leave for school 8-ish or whatever. Yeah,
I think school started at 8:30 for us.
8:30. Okay.
Sounds pretty nice.
And then would be picked up and then be there when school got out, usually till 5 or 6.
And they'd do, like, activities. Like, ours was like, we'll teach you how to play the piano.
Exactly. Yeah. Usually you're just like, I guess I'll just sit here and get my homework done.
Yeah.
But it was so boring. There was no TV, nothing like that. You kind of had to be engaged with a fellow student and using your mind and whatever.
Because you weren't allowed to, like, bring a book either. They'd be like, do your homework, or we have, like, pipe cleaners you can make something with.
Yes. If I remember that correctly, it was just sort of like, oh, my God, I can't wait for my mom to get here. But, I think for whatever reason, when we got old enough, and my parents probably wanted to, like, pull back the finances a little bit. But when we were really little, like, we 100% were daycare kids.
One sibling, two siblings? Was it?
I've got a younger brother.
Okay, just you and your brother.
Yep, and I mean, to me, too, my memories sometimes with TV, they're just so vivid because when you are awake at 6 a.m. and your babysitter plops you down in front of the TV from 6 a.m. to 8 in the morning, every morning was original Pink Panther cartoon.
She-Ra?
Yeah, oh, for sure, too. But Inspector Gadget was always on in that time frame. And then I always felt like right when the cartoons were like really heating up, you had to go to school. And you're
Dennis the Menace is just starting.
I know.
Heathcliff, that would always be in the morning in Boston. But just,
yeah, like the 6 a.m. to 7 a.m. block of cartoon watching was always super weird and a throwback because it was like, yeah, these
what's cheap?
Well, of course. And you're like, this is... Well, yeah, you're literally watching scored, like Henry Mancini, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Scored Henry Mancini cartoons with no words, no dialogue.
For European.
Yeah. Yeah. And like that's the first thing your little brain sees for years on end. So that is like a really, like when I see it, it makes me feel weird and creepy.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, whoa, these memories
It's not bad, but it's just something's weird. Yeah. It's like that, they always, and I think this is clinically true, but like smell is the best mnemonic device. So often I'll get hit with a smell and I'll get like memory flashes and then I have to like reverse engineer what the hell I'm remembering because it's so just tied directly to the memory. So it's almost like that. I'm sorry, you're getting bitten. I apologize. They are hovering. But like, and I'll be like, what the hell was that? And it's almost that effect where you're like, it's not when people think back on a memory, they're like, oh, and I remember this person was there, we were doing this. It's almost more like weirdly primal. It's just shorting right to like, what the hell was that?
Oh, yeah. Because my memories of childhood are so attached to, you know, everything weird and good or bad or whatever. Like, it's just so strange being raised by just a weird Midwestern couple who they had their own kids who were all, two of them were fully in high school. And then the other had, like, already graduated, and I think he was, like, 19 and already divorced with, like, two kids, and he would work in the garage. But, like, so we were literally raised by, like, Roseanne and Dan.
Yeah.
They were – this family was Elaine and Dan, and they were the Brights, and, like, they had three children, even though they were much older, not, like, the Connor kids per se, but, like – there's a reason we all sat down and watched Roseanne together as a family because I was just like, this is who I'm raised by, technically.
Yeah.
It's not my mom and dad, but, like, these families are very real.
It's close enough. Yeah, like, did you find that comforting and in the familiarity or kind of, like, anxiety-inducing?
Anxiety-inducing. Yeah. I mean, like, you're sitting here going, like, well, these people run a daycare out of their house for a living, so clearly nothing's really nice.
Things haven't worked out.
Everything is just had juice spilled on it. Yeah. Like, I just remember that whole environment was dirty, smelled, was sticky. And then you've got like two burnout teenagers living in the house. So if we'd ever like open the door and see what Chris was doing,
which you don't want to see.
Right. And we quickly learned it's like Chris had like the longest toenails. He was like he was like a computer geek, like an 80s computer geek.
It's like a poor Howard Hughes.
Never took a shower. Terrible acne, huge glasses, was like somehow like 15 with a pot belly.
Yep.
You know, Ari has that like, you know, and you're just like, oh God, like you open the door and you'd be like, what's that? Like, hey, Chris. And you'd be like, oh no. And
it's then, like a Christian hell house. And then, in here, the computer whiz.
And then in the other room, Barb, she let her, like Elaine would let her smoke in her bedroom.
Of course.
And Barb was always crying and always had mascara running down her face.
It's like Tammy Faye Baker.
No, she really was. She had the worst, most fried blonde 80s hair. God. And she was always like, she was so strung out and definitely like in an abusive, 17-year-old relationship with somebody. She was so angry, so moody.
I did it because I love you so much, baby.
And
every
day. Just like, this was like down the hall.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We kind of had our areas that the kids were cordoned to. Like when the sun came up, we could run around in the backyard and play on a broken, rusty swing set.
Probably pulled out of a playground that was getting rid of it.
Seriously. Yeah.
But you're constantly aware that's around
you. I was like, it's really nice to go home because my house isn't like this.
I mean, that was, it's funny you mentioned that because although, you know, not the Midwest, but like in Boston, my mother would do the same thing and drop me off at her parents' house. Mm-hmm. And my grandmother was literally passed out from martinis, like, and I would mix drinks, and then she'd get up and play Nintendo. She was like, she was this like 50-year-old deaf lady who would just get drunk and from work. And then my grandfather was an old, angry Norwegian World War II vet, and he worked there was a veterans hospital in Cambridge called Uville Hospital. He ran the boiler room, which was literally like four subterranean levels of wrought iron. It looked like Freddy Krueger's boiler room. And they'd like drop me off at there and be like, hang with your grandfather. And it was literally like hell. And he'd just sit down there and smoke. And when he would go home, he would sit in the in the kitchen at the table in the dark with a wife beater on, his like Dickies pants that were too short, and just smoke in the dark. And there was a nicotine ring above. And everything smelled. They'd like, you know, smelled like stagnant water and like sort of rodents. And then my youngest uncle, who's only 8 years older than me, was like the burnout teenager. And he'd be high. And I remember I'd come in and I'm like six and I'm like I like reading and whatever. Yeah, right. And he'd be totally stoned, which I didn't know at the time, eating like raw steakums and like quick powdered chocolate milk with a spoon, you know, just be like, oh. So I loved going home, and my sister liked hanging out there. Like, she thought it was cool. And I was like, God, no. Oh, no. We need to go home where things are clean and there's not burnout teenagers.
Well, prior to the Brights, I mean, then I was fully raised by a hillbilly. And she lived in like a little, you know, I love her. She was a good woman. Don't get me wrong, but this was like when my parents really were, you know, we both work. My dad's a police officer. My mom's a nurse. And so it's like they were both full time at the lowest end of their pay scale at that point in their life. They're in their early 20s.
Yeah. And getting weird shifts.
Well, because, yeah, both my parents would. They never, thankfully, as far as I knew, both got midnight shift at the same time.
Right.
But they would alternate that, you know. So, yes, exactly. Getting the shit shifts. No seniority. And so I think the person they found that they could afford was this hillbilly named Dorothy, who I was raised in just a one room that had the washer and dryer, a CB radio, and AstroTurf.
CB radio.
Yeah, like CB radio.
And breaker, breaker.
She would listen to the police scanner.
My grandfather used to do that.
Yep, we would listen to the police scanner. Or then when it moved out of that, you know, time of day for her, then it'd be honky-tonk. But, you know, like her family, full-on Michigan white trash redneck family would come over. Literal family feuds and fights would break out in the house and in the yard. We would get locked in her wardrobe in her bedroom. For safety. And then my dad would be so embarrassed because it would come over their scanner that the address where his children are babysat.
Because he's a police officer.
Because he's a police officer. He would have to report to his own babysitter.
Go pick up your kid.
Right. Jeez. I mean, first things first, he'd get us out of the wardrobe, put us in the police car, and then go break up.
Oh, dear
bullshit.
God.
So, like,
I'm just picturing it like in Roger and Me when he goes to that woman who sells rabbits and she's like, pets or food? I don't care. Pets or food? I'm just picturing that woman. Yeah.
She was, I mean.
Because that's Flint, but yeah.
No, Flint, I know. But like, she would do things like, and I would be driven to school in her gigantic robin's egg blue Oldsmobile with just bench seats. She'd turn the corner and like, there was no seatbelt. And
slide.
I just was sliding across and I'd be dropped off while all the other Richie Rich kids were 100% in the 80s, you know, pulling up with. Because, you know, I went to private school, but we got a deep discount because we actually were the churchgoers there.
Right.
Where other people are like, no, we don't go to church. We want our kids to go to private school, though. Yeah. Or whatever. So, you know, it was just one of those things where, yeah, I'd get dropped off by the hillbilly. And then she would always give me a bag of old shoes to ask if I wanted.
Go through these.
She'd be like, ask your first grade teacher if she wants any of these shoes. And I was like, I don't want to, Dorothy. Yeah. You know?
They're all left shoes.
And then, like, I would come in and she'd like, take them, you know? And I'd be walking into the class with a paper bag. And then my teacher would be like, what's in the bag? And I was like, nothing.
Funny you should ask. I was
going
to ask
you. What's in the bag? And I'd be like, Dorothy wants to know if you want these shoes. And you know when, like, a teacher can't.
They don't want to say that.
Like, she fully had that adult moment of like, what the fuck? And was in tears laughing. And I was like, I didn't want to ask you if you wanted old orthopedic shoes. But there was no TV at Dorothy's.
No, like, it was
nothing.
Originally, my grandparents just had they had this old TV, which no cable or anything.
Nope.
And it got one channel, and something was broken on it, and you couldn't turn it off,
mm-hmm.
which was like hell on earth. I don't know what, obviously you could unplug it, but it wasn't like you unplugged it. It's still on. But it was just, it was awful. Like, everything you've said completely rings true with me. Although, like, those fight people were my uncles. We would always have cops show up, and there was a cop named, I forget what his first name was, but his nickname was Tabba, because he kept tabs on everybody. Tabba O'Leary. And he lived, you know, the O'Leary's lived down the street, and there was like eight kids there. God. And he came to look for my uncle who had stolen a pig, beat up a cop, took the cop's badge and hat, put it on the pig, and then thrown the pig through the window of the police station because he was bored.
Okay.
So they came looking for him, and he was like, "Hey, Mr. Tonneson, I'm just looking for Annie. You know where he is?" And my grandfather goes, "Get the fuck out of my house, Tabba." And then he's like, "Okay, Mr. Tonneson." Like, he's the police. Like, why is this a thing? It was like constantly, yeah, like these. And every single – my grandfather and all my uncles on that side only drove cars – they bought at police auctions. It would constantly be a different car. Like, I remember my uncle got this like Chevy Blazer that had this couple's name like pinstriped on the doors. It was like Big Ed and Martha. Like, I'm like, what is this car? Yeah. Or a lot of cars with car phones, because they were all drug dealer cars.
Oh my
God. Yeah. So I am with you 100% on this.
Yeah. My parents don't have the full scope of how my brother and I were actually raised.
And if you ever try to bring it up, I don't know if they're like, there was no rule book. We did the best we could. I get that a lot.
My mom, I mean, I feel for her. Like, she definitely cries when you bring it up, because she's literally like, if I could have done it differently, you know.
But it's a condemnation of them in a way to them.
To them. But she does feel bad. She feels bad that, like, you know, like this idea where, you know, of course she's a woman with a career who didn't necessarily even like want to get married or have kids, and kind of got not like bullied into the whole thing, but.
That generation, life happens. Yeah.
Didn't, like, she wasn't set up to have any other examples to know how to go against the grain, even though, you know, I feel like I'm that person that she couldn't be.
Which is what parents do. They try to,
But she does get really sad. Like, not, like, she basically had a quick maternity leave, and then we were raised by certified white trash.
Yeah. But you got to pay the bills. Like, that's the thing. It's like, you have to do it. And, like, I think a lot of people of our parents' generation, especially women, like, that's how they got out of their parents' house. They got married.
And
that's it.
That's how they both, like, truly ended up having, like, very comfortable salaries after, you know, we just were.
Yeah.
We were, yeah.
Got to make a couple sacrifices. But Turkey TV helped.
when I would come home after all of that garbage I was put through. Yeah. Before and after school room, or being at the Brights, and then Christian school, for God's sake.
Oof, yeah.
And then hopefully getting home around 4:30 or 5 and be like, I need my Turkey TV.
Take your bonnet off. It's our Turkey TV.
Oh, that's so bad.
Oh, my. What else?
Kids are not going to, like, I don't even think I'm going to have kids.
Yeah,
fine. But if I had them, you know, I'd be like, listen, not that I'm going to let you be this, like, choose your own adventure sort of kid, but, like, I promise you this. You will not be raised by hillbillies.
Yes, hillbillies will not have any part in your raising. No. Yeah, that is, oh boy. Yeah, and then I would get yelled at, like, if I was like, hey, I don't want to go to grandpa's house. And they'd be like, what do you think, you're better than everyone? And I'd be like, I'm 10 years old.
I would be like, please let me go to my grandparents' house, because they were rich. And all they did was buy us Doritos.
Oh, that's
and
sweet.
And my memories are so sharp of weekends at my grandmother's, and Friday night when it, you know, because I picked 88, but later on when it was, you know, the Friday
TGIF
night,
TGIF, and SNCC.
Never ending, great, just like my grandmother had the best pop secret, full butter. Like, we would all get our own bag.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my
own bag of carcinogen filled popcorn.
Oh, we are popcorn monsters, my family. I remember the first time I went to another family and watched them eat popcorn, and I was like, oh, wait, you don't take the biggest handful you can and then literally try and jam, like, your whole fist. I'm talking, like, 40 kernels at once, maybe 50. And my whole family would do it. Like, you'd look over and everyone's like,
chipmunk cheek packing popcorn in there.
And I would watch other families do, like, two kernels at once.
They have like chopsticks.
Exactly.
One at a time.
Like, whoa. I remember like correcting myself real fast after I was about to do like the claw into my face and then was like, oh, no one else seems to be doing this.
You're like Eliza Doolittle and you're like, I don't know how this is eaten.
I'll die how to eat popcorn, sir.
Now I just want to write something where someone goes to someone's house and their family eats popcorn one kernel at a time with chopsticks and they're like, is that how it's supposed to be done? It's a sophisticated way to eat the popcorn.
Of course, we did that on Hack My Life as like ways to keep your hands clean or whatever.
Oh, really?
And I was just like, we did it with chopsticks. And I was like, this isn't the worst. No. But I also love popcorn. You're supposed to put your hand on it. That's why it's a fun food.
It really is. And you only ever have popcorn at fun things. Like you're watching a movie, it's a special treat. Like there's no one who's ever like, I had to survive on popcorn when I lived under a bridge or something. You know, like there's no one has
like
bad popcorn.
You're at the bar,
the fair.
A bowl of popcorn on a bar counter where you're like, how many fingers have been here? Don't care.
There was a bar when I was growing up in Massachusetts in Cambridge called the Cambridge Port. Mm-hmm. And all the punk rock kids hung out there because they never checked IDs. So they'd serve like 10-year-olds. But and it was like this old man Cambridge bar, like the kind of bar you see in any like McMob movie, like the Departed bar. And instead, the food they gave out wasn't popcorn, wasn't pretzels. On every table and on the bar were little bowls of potato salad.
Gross.
And people would eat it. I've never heard of this.
It's been a hot minute, but like the probably in Detroit because it's also like really Polish and some of the bars we would go to, they would have the jars of pickled eggs.
Oh God.
Ugh.
With a lutefisk or something, or like, oh boy. Things are better now, everybody's not. That's how you got dysentery, from four-day-old bean salad that's on the counter at a VFW hall bar. Kids are fine now. Yeah, it was just cotton peas. And I was like 13 or 14. I'm like, why are you eating that? When they're like, what? It's free.
It's free, man.
Yeah, but that's kids.
We're like, but awesome. That has mayonnaise on it.
Yeah, and they're like, whatever. Doesn't kill me, makes me strong. And we used to, there was a McDonald's near there that, when they let franchises kind of have a little more free reign, used to do a thing like in the last hour they were open called Bag-O Burgers. And for $5, they just throw as many burgers as they could in a bag that they just want to get rid of. So like we lived on those, but often they would mostly be frozen. We just eat them. Just eat them. Oof. Yeah. Don't know how I'm alive. But that's why I have superpowers now. What else you have on there?
Well, I was laughing that, like, on a Monday evening, and I was thinking that I was like, I definitely probably watched Leave It to Beaver. I mean, I was a Leave It to Beaver kid the whole time, and even the reboot, you know.
The new Leave It to Beaver was amazing.
It was so good. I loved seeing Wally and, you know, everyone grown up.
But really dramatic. That was the crazy thing. It was, like, single cam, and it was about, like, middle-aged people's struggles and how they raise their kids. And it was so weird to see that in, like, 1986.
Absolutely. And you're like, wow, they really spun this, you know, because how fake and ridiculous and like the actual problems like Beaver and, you know, Wally and Eddie and Lumpy and everyone would have were like, oh please, you know, I'd watch it, I'd enjoy it, but I'd be like a little drama, por favor, you know.
Something, some stakes here maybe.
Some
although
stakes, you
I've rewatched that as an adult.
I do think Beaver lied one time and got in
once.
Trouble.
You know
for
Beaver,
it.
When you lie. Have you ever revisited that as an adult? Especially as a writer.
I haven't seen it in a long time. Like, I haven't had cable probably in 12 years.
Yeah.
That is the one thing I kind of miss is, like, you know, you've got all your, you know, Nickelodeon, all the channels that used to, like, all day long would be, like, My Three Sons.
Yeah,
Leave
Mr.
It to
Ed.
Beaver, I Love Lucy. Mr. Ed. Yeah, you just said Mr. Ed. But, but I loved Leave It to Beaver and the reboot, which, was it a Disney Channel
It started on Disney for one season, and then they canceled it, and then TBS picked it up, and then did another four seasons. And it was a lot like The Wonder Years. It was weird. It's very good. It's never been released since that. I have bootlegs of it, but it's good, and I never really liked Leave It to Beaver that much as a kid, because it was so saccharine, and it was like the... And I really loved SCTV, and they did an amazing, like, brutal sketch of Leave It to Beaver.
Right,
and so I was
right.
like, yeah, this show's lame. But I've revisited because, like, MeTV or Antenna or someone like that. And the thing that strikes me now, and I'm curious if you ever revisit it, how it would strike you, is the dialogue between the kids is amazingly realistic.
Yeah.
But they talk like kids.
But Ward and June are like paper cutouts.
Yeah.
Ridiculous.
And it's so weird, though, to hear someone – kid dialogue ring true in most things, but especially then. They talk like kids. They have like weird things that bother them like kids. And it's kind of shocking to me how well that part of it's done.
That's probably why it was a success.
Yeah.
You know, after all, without people realizing
that
like they're kind of actually letting kids be kids.
Yeah. And talk like kids do instead of like 40-year-old vaudeville writers. Oh, boy.
My favorite thing, too, is I used to write for my school newspaper. I was... Yes, thank you.
Yes, very studious.
That's right. That's right. In high school, I went as the... I was the school newspaper photographer. I was like the photo editor, if you will. So I would get the special perks. Yep. I could kind of get press pass and be like, Brooke Van Poppelen from the RHS Talon here. Yeah. And
do you have a hat that said scoop on it?
Exactly. But I went, because I was like, oh my God, how ridiculous is this? So in Troy, Michigan, which is the suburban city, like pretty much next to Rochester, but there's the most ridiculous intersection of a major thoroughway road with 69, which is one of the highways of 69.
Okay.
The road it intersects with is Big Beaver. So Big Beaver and 69, right? And then there was Big Beaver. I don't think it was called Big Beaver Bowling Lanes, but it was probably called like Thunderbird or something. But a new bowling alley opened up. But because it was on Big Beaver Road, they managed to wrangle Jerry Mathers for the lanes like opening.
Cutting the ribbon. You
know, exactly. And I fully went out to interview him for the school newspaper, have a photo of me and Jerry Mathers.
Do you still have it?
Yeah. Oh, I'll send it to you. Yeah, I have my mom scan it.
That's amazing.
And send it to me.
How did it hold up? Were you like, wow, I'm talking to the Beaver?
I loved it. I gave him a hug. He wore his like Letterman cardigan from, you know.
He's a pretty nice guy.
He's like, a really nice guy. And because that was probably like 1994 or 95 or something when I went to do that. So, I mean, you know, he wasn't obsolete, if you will.
No,
you know,
he would pop up in things.
Totally.
Like, have you ever seen Back to the Beach?
I don't think so.
One of my favorite movies.
Okay.
It's Frankie and Annette.
Oh, okay.
And it's from 1989, and the premise is they come back to Malibu because their daughter, played by Lori Loughlin, lives there, and they revisit all the old beach people. But, like, a ton of people from 50s and 60s TV are in it. And there's a big surf competition at the end, and Wally, the Beaver, and the mother, Barbara Billingsley, are the judges.
Yeah.
And it's really funny. Like, they would pop up and stuff like that.
Of course, because it's like, what a great cameo.
Oh, yeah. But
that was like a cannot miss
sort of
situation where I was like, I'm gonna go get the scoop for the newspaper.
Yeah. Well, you weren't probably having like a ton of celebrities come through there at that time.
No.
I mean, you know.
But I also was like, this is so hokey, but I have to go cover it.
You were aware.
Oh yeah, I wrote a kind of tongue in cheek.
It's 94. You're probably reading Sassy. Mm-hmm. Probably getting that tone in there. You know,
there was a budding comedian on the rise.
Yes,
for sure.
Which is a total like, oh, I gotta go to that.
And I kind of mocked the whole thing, and you know, but I was also sweet about it. I was genuinely excited to meet him.
It wasn't, you weren't making fun of him. You were probably mocking the situation.
Right, where I'm like, this is...
I mean, there's a Big Beaver.
There's a Big Beaver.
Yeah.
Big Beaver in 69.
69. My God. What else we get on there?
Definitely would watch, like, Elf was like a family sit-down situation.
Yes.
And now they are they're streaming Elf on Hulu now.
Yeah.
Which I watched the pilot episode.
It's terrible.
Oh, it's so bad. But I was just like, I love this show. And we loved it. And you're like, how? Of all of the bizarre pitches that have certainly gone through where everyone's like, that's absurd. No, 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 no. But
this one goes.
Elf from Melmac, who's a cat-eating...
Well, it was
stranded alien, incredibly lives
with the Tanner family and the Mrs. Mark Elf
brother and I were talking about how it was, but that was stroke every episode.
Elf, please. Well, it's so weird because like Brendan Tartikoff at NBC. That because that channel was doing so badly, that network, he was just greenlighting stuff that he personally liked. So none of it made any sense. Like, you know, Misfits of Science and Punky Brewster and these shows that like no one would greenlight that.
But I love those shows. Yeah, you
and
know,
it was his taste, which you don't get now.
No, you don't, because I'm like, where are the wild shows like this? Well, instead you get like, you know, we're like, of course Cavemen got canceled. Like, right. Please, right. You know.
It's too high concept to make it go past a couple episodes.
Totally.
But I always talk about, too, like the 50s, 60s, those like hidden, we have a hidden magical being in our house shows, like My Favorite Martian, I Dream a Genie, My Mother the Car, Bewitched. Right. There was a ton of them. And in the 80s, that resurged because the 80s and the 50s culturally were very similar. So facetiously, but also I kind of believe this, if you replace that magical being with a gay son, it's kind of the same thing. We're like, we can't let the neighbors know, because you had, or there was a subgenre of like teenage girls with magical powers that had to suppress them.
Yes.
So like Out of This World, you know, Alex Mack a little later, but you had that kind of thing too. And Alf sort of fell into that realm. But then you had some really bad Alf ripoffs like Scorch, which was about people who had a little puppet dragon. And the most terrifying one ever starred Stephen Dorff, and it was called What a Dummy. And it was this family whose father was a vaudeville ventriloquist who dies and bequeaths them his dummy, who's actually alive and lives with this family.
Wow.
Yeah.
Horrifying. Didn't catch that one.
Yeah, horrifying. There's clips online where it's Stephen Dorff talking to an absolutely terrifying speaking ventriloquist dummy. And I blame Al for that.
I blame Al.
Yes.
I also blame Stephen Dorff.
It was all Stephen Dorff's fault. I just opened this up, and I'm surprised. I don't know if you saw this on Tuesday. There's an afternoon special called Mom Touched Me, A Mother's Love Turns to Abuse.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
I mean.
You didn't see that angle happen very often.
No, not really.
But the scariest, I was terrified of all adults in the 80s because of every day it was stories like that on TV.
Every day, and every after school special was 100% trying to, you know, warn you of the perils and the dangers.
Yes.
Yet in the meantime, I mean, my parents were actually pretty strict with us.
Yeah.
There were how many hours during every day where they had no idea? They assumed hillbillies were keeping an eye on us.
Yeah, you know, we're mostly fine.
You know, we're mostly fine.
You're in the wardrobe.
You know, we talk about this all the time, or I laugh and listen to, like, you know, my lady friends who do, like, My Favorite Murder.
Yeah, yeah.
Talking about, like, in the 80s, it was just like, you just ride off into the day or night on your bike, and you'd be like, I'll be home in 2 hours.
Before it's dark.
Whatever. Exactly, before it's dark. That was a big thing. And do I realize that that's a great way for kids to go missing? I sure do. But also, when it doesn't go that way, I'm like, I'm so glad I was able to have a childhood like that.
Yeah.
Like, to kind of have the, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Not authority, but just the self.
Autonomy?
Yeah, the autonomy. Yeah. That's the word I'm looking for.
Well, they talk about that too. Like, self-guided play is like how kids learn how to do things.
And totally.
Like, I always think of myself as like a really sedentary TV kid. But then when I actually think about it, I'm like, I was out all the time. I was like in the woods and like, you know, doing all kinds of stuff. And I was fine.
Yep.
And it's for all they told us of kids getting kidnapped, I don't know anyone. Or, like, there was always, like, you'll get hooked on drugs. They'll throw you in a van and give you heroin. And then, like, you're hooked.
Right. I mean, there are enough scary stories to make it a thing. But
yeah.
When you're thinking of all the communities, like, I actually don't, like, we had a lot of ridiculous tragic deaths kind of happen.
Oh, same, yeah.
But it wasn't kidnapping.
No, they were, like, misadventure or accidents
exactly.
kind of stuff.
Exactly, yeah. Or just freak, like... Just for, you know, like this kid in my grade school, like, shot his sister in the head with a BB gun, and she was basically, she's mentally disabled for the rest of her life.
Wonderful.
So that was wild.
Cautionary tales.
Yeah, cautionary tales, you know, but that was like kid on kid BB violence.
Yeah,
And, you know, but, and even my dad is a cop, like, he was so paranoid.
Yeah.
That, like, we could, you know, he grew up that way too, where it was just like, bye mom, see you later, we're gonna be down at, because my grandfather was a pharmacist and literally had a soda fountain.
Excellent.
So they're
love,
like,
your family.
My family's ridiculous. Van Poppelen pharmacy. But you know, so we grew up that way too, because my mom and her family, you know, grew up like during every summer, like on the lake, because her dad was a park ranger and all this stuff. And it's like the woods and like you're saying, the autonomy of being a kid. At least the rule was, like, be with your friends, buddy system.
Yeah, like, you're not alone. And now it's weird that they don't let them do that when you literally could track your kid if you needed
to. Yeah,
you can let them do it, and you're like, I know exactly where you are.
Or give them a phone.
Yeah, it's just bizarre. Because then I'm also like, you know, as I grew up, I'm like, no, I know teenagers and adults who are drug addicts. They're not giving it away.
Yeah.
Like, that's not their main priority. Let me give this to other people. That's the opposite of what they do.
Look what I got in my trunk. You know, well, because my dad was a D.A.R.E. officer for a while.
Oh, do you have the suitcase? So
he had the suitcase, but we were taught to stay away from drugs and alcohol. Our school community had the money for an actual life-size robot named S.A.R.G.E.
Hold on a moment.
He wore a police chief hat.
Okay.
So one police officer would stand in the hallway and do the remote control. Yes. So S.A.R.G.E. would come rolling in.
Someone have the mic.
Yep, and then would sit back there and do the voice on the mic. And then the other cop would, you know, they had their rehearsed,
Have you discussed this before?
No, we haven't.
Oh, my God. This is incredible.
And so he would come out, and he had a boombox on his chest, and it would play the Hawaii Five-O theme song.
So he's like Conky from Pee-wee, yes! Basically, as a cop.
Yes. And, you know, and so he'd do this whole sort of assembly for our school, you know, like, don't do drugs. Yeah. And my dad would
Drugs do not compute.
But they talk about stranger danger and all this stuff. And that was like the cool shit that when we were kids, because I had the, you know, the privilege of being a police officer's daughter,
yeah,
even though my dad wasn't the D.A.R.E. officer when I was a kid, like, I got to walk in with S.A.R.G.E. because I knew the police officers.
I know S.A.R.G.E.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, I know S.A.R.G.E. and I got to like walk in front of the school with them, and then they're like, all right, sit down, you know,
Were you old enough to know that it wasn't a real robot? I mean, I guess,
yeah,
it's technically a real robot.
But it was like, this is crazy, yeah, and cool. Like, everyone, so now they've like downgraded the age. I think they don't do D.A.R.E. programs like that,
yeah,
anymore. So now S.A.R.G.E. teaches like kindergartners.
Oh, they still have S.A.R.G.E.
Oh, yeah. S.A.R.G.E. So when my
dad... Did it stand for something? Like S.A.R.G.E.?
No, I don't think it was an acronym. But so now they realize, like, all right, kids are too savvy.
Yeah.
Like, you could get away with it in our sort of, yeah, like, generation up through eighth grade.
Right.
Now S.A.R.G.E. he got a makeover, so it's a new S.A.R.G.E. And he looks a little nicer and less clunky.
A little sleek.
And so, I mean, he's got his own, like, stall that's like a hitch that comes on the back of, like, a police van.
Like a S.A.R.G.E. sidecar?
Oh, yeah, it's a S.A.R.G.E. sidecar.
Wow.
And so he rolls in I went with my dad to watch him do the, to do the presentation for,
yeah,
kindergartners and first graders, and they are all losing their minds.
I bet.
I started crying because it was so cute.
Yeah.
It brought back like all these memories because I was trying to do a video of it because I wanted to pitch it as a This American Life story.
Oh, yeah.
And then I like couldn't get the foot. This is like that weird time. I won't even get into this. This is that weird intersection in technology in like 2009 when it's like I didn't have an iPhone yet.
Right.
I didn't have a Mac. I couldn't get like a dumb like SIM card out of the,
yeah,
shitty video recorder I borrowed from a friend. Like, there was just
It was
no...
possible to do, but really difficult.
It was so, yeah, hard. Like, I was like, I cannot find anywhere to store this footage, let alone now get it off this stupid.
Yeah.
So anyways, it's really heartbreaking. I don't know where it is. I might have to go dig it up. But so the kids go crazy. Love it. Like, I'm crying just because I'm like, this is just so sweet. And then it gets real dark because then the police, you know, they're all off doing their own thing. And then I followed my dad and his partner out around the corner. And then, you know, they take S.A.R.G.E. apart. They, like,
yeah,
pop his head off and shit like that,
yeah,
and just, like, jam him back in the,
throw him,
you know,
in a suitcase.
And you're like,
yeah,
like, oh, God.
Yeah.
These kids can't come out here and see this.
We got to put S.A.R.G.E. down, kids. Yeah. Well, that's why they have the rule at amusement parks that you're never to take the head off until you're home.
Yes.
Because some kid will see it and think that they're... Tony V, who's a Boston comic, who's in a lot of Bobcat Goldthwait stuff.
Oh, okay, cool.
He used to be the gorilla for Samsonite suitcases,
okay,
or luggage. And he was doing an appearance with a friend of his who was dressed up as some cartoon character. I don't know who, mm-hmm, it was, but let's say Mickey Mouse. And the guy was a comic, so he was hungover. And he starts puking in the head. And so he's like, I got to get this head off. And he's like, you can't. Like, there's kids around. He's like, please. There's like all puke in there, right? So they
just
go, yeah, so they go hide. Like, they think they're hiding. And Tony can't get this head off. So he's dressed as a gorilla. And he puts his foot on the guy's shoulder and pulls the head off. And puke all comes out. So it looks like blood.
Like blood.
And these kids start screaming. And they're like, the gorilla killed Mickey Mouse. And he's like, oh, I guess that's why you don't take the heads off.
Why you don't,
yeah,
do it.
That's why you don't do it. Man, I feel so bad that we didn't have a S.A.R.G.E. We had a guy who had the drug suitcase.
Yep.
And maybe you can ask someone who may know if this was just him going off script or if this was part of the D.A.R.E. program. But he pulls out, goes through all the drugs, pulls out a jar of natural peanut butter. And he goes, you kids know what this is? Yeah, it's peanut butter, right? You love it. But look at this. And he takes the thing off, and this is all the oil on the top. Okay. And he goes, yeah, kids will take this oil, put it in a syringe, inject it into themselves, and then they die. And we were like, what? Like, none of us would ever even think of that. Like, I don't know why.
You're like, yeah. What the fuck? You're like, I like, okay, I get that there's like Tide Pods and butt chugging yeah. and like all this terrible stuff.
Not that.
Never.
That sounds like a overly dramatic
kid. He's like,
kid
you know why they die? Yeah. Too much cholesterol yep. too fast.
Their hearts will explode in about 20 to 30 years if they do this every day. But or like some kid with a peanut allergy who just wants to die. Like, that's how he did it. He injected himself with peanut oil.
Oh,
but I don't think, I don't think that was a standard D.A.R.E. protocol. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh boy. They die. And then we all had the fake story that they probably told everyone who was like, kid did LSD, thought he was in a glass of orange juice, had to wear a hat all the time so he didn't spill. Life's ruined forever. Or the kid who thought he was an orange tried to peel himself. That was one. And I'm like, did they, even at 8 hours, like, I don't think these happened.
Come on,
yeah.
Man.
But I'd like to see all the cops. Like in the locker room coming up with those stories. Like, what's a good one we can tell these kids so they don't do LSD?
That would be kind of amazing to maybe this is just an idea, maybe a story pitch, you know, and we can credit it. Maybe we'll work on it together. But like we'll pitch like This American Life.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about this off.
Yes, yes. This I like where you're going with this. Mm-hmm. Yep. Mm-hmm. I'm picturing a whiteboard, be like, here's the drugs.
Yeah.
What's the thing?
Exactly.
We also had a guy named Roscoe who came in, who was a former drug addict, and told us about not to do drugs. And he this guy, he did a rap song, and he goes, this is a syringe. People put drugs in it. I seen a man put this in his penis. I seen a woman put it in her vagina. And I don't think the school vetted this at all. So this guy, he goes, I used to love horse tranquilizers. And he goes, I do them. I end up in the Filene's basement in the women's undergarment section with brassieres on my head. And we're like, is this guy real? And then the thing that made them pull the plug on it was he did a rap song that included the line, I use profanity to talk to the kids, which was amazing. And then he pulled out a broom and he goes, listen up. I was in prison, y'all. This thing here, I seen it go up in a man, and he died. And they were like, nope. The teachers pulled the plug. That was the final thing. And as an adult now and knowing, like, the people that we know, I'm like, was this guy just totally making this up, seeing how far he could go? Because I'm like, he's like, they haven't stopped yet. I guess I'll do the broom thing. So, like, I don't know if that is. Yeah. This is a broom, right? Yeah, you've all seen it.
Oh my god. My friend Jocelyn and I had a sketch show that we're like, we should bring it back. It's so great. But we play these like ridiculous, clearly closeted female cops. But yeah. Like, we're just like, what? No, gross. Like, we definitely like totally love each other. But we do this whole like D.A.R.E. presentation as Terry and Reggie. And it's, I mean, I was just so proud of it. Like, we did a really bad rap and a whole. You know, you have, like, everyone needs the toolbox, you know, and, like, for saying no to drugs and alcohol and whatever. And, you know, we'd pull it out, do a can thing. She'd hold up, you know, something. She'd be like, look, Brooke. Or be like, Reggie, check it out. I'm really hammered right now.
You know?
Or holding a hammer.
Kids just love like, it. Kids love it.
Kids love it. And we just had this whole sketch, and we did a bad, you know, white lady rap and dance and the whole thing. Like, do what drugs is cool, you know, blah, blah, blah. Or, no, whatever. I can't wait. Obviously not doing drugs is cool.
Maybe that would be the angle. I feel like that would be more effective. Like if those people came in and were total dorks that kids hate and be like, kids, listen up. Drugs are awesome. I do them. My partner does them and we're cool. Kids would be like, nope, thank you.
Yeah. Exactly. Reverse psychology.
Because they always, they'll, and I feel so bad because they're sincere and they're trying to help.
They'll
be like, you know, you don't have to do it like a nerd. You could say, hey man, yo. I'm not down with that, but it's cool if you do it. Maybe you should stop, my friend.
Right.
Something like that. I don't know.
Something that just flows and is natural.
In your voice.
Your street smart.
Yes. Oh, wow. Anyway. This is fantastic. Anything else you have on there?
You know, the only other thing I was thinking just to, you know, obviously Full House was on. I don't really want to talk about it. I don't have that many awesome memories from watching Full. Like, I watched it, but I'm that person who felt literally nothing.
Yeah.
Other than being annoyed when I'm like, oh, this is coming back.
Well, there were shows that we all watched that we didn't even like. Exactly. Like, Perfect Strangers is that show for me. I'm like, oh, watched it religiously every week. Did not enjoy it.
Yep.
Who's the Boss? Didn't like it. Watched not it every really, week.
No.
But not hate watch like people do now.
Not hate watch. I was just like, this is my it's appetizer on. For Family Matters.
Because yeah.
that's the one.
Yes, like, well, of course.
So much funnier.
But, yeah, until that show is one of the classic. I'm like, a show goes more than four seasons, it automatically gets weird because they've run out of things to do. But that one started as a blue-collar show about a cop and his wife and became a show about a nerd who has a time machine.
Yeah, I mean.
That's a literal way that that show, yeah, I don't understand it and I never will.
Yeah, the only thing I really have on you, because I was like going back to, I was like, well, okay, clearly I didn't watch, like when I was 10, I'm just trying to think too that like, I was looking through everything on there. I was like, no, I'm guessing either my parents let like my brother and I like put on a movie.
Right.
Or we
were you like
we
Friday were in, night
we
rent
were,
a movie?
Like, in bed by like 8:30.
Did you have
10.
A bedtime or that's just when you went?
No, because I, you know, my parents were like, go the fuck to bed.
Right.
We were always in bed so early.
Right.
We were always made to come in earlier than all of our other friends, even in the summertime.
What?
Our curfew was 9, and like in Michigan, because you're as far west in the eastern time zone as you can be, it's light out till 10 p.m. So in the summertime, you know, like we would be made to come in and then we lived in a cul-de-sac at that point and my brother and I would continue playing with the kids in the court but yelling from our bedroom window.
From like, the window?
Yeah, they'd all still be like playing kick the can and I'd be like, she's hiding over there! Like,
you guys want to play Cyrano de Bergerac?
Yeah, and we just like, our parents were such stickler killjoys with all that stuff. But
yeah.
we were like, if I was 10, I was probably made to go to bed around 8.
Oh my God. I never had a bedtime, which was because my parents were bad parents. But in hindsight, I'm kind of like, yeah. just, like they didn't want to have to deal with anything.
Right.
So they were just like, we're going to bed, but you know, whatever.
You do whatever.
Yeah, whatever you do. You, yeah.
you know, but definitely if I was 10, because then what makes sense is, but then like a little later, as I got a little bit older, this would only be like about a year or so later. As a family, like, this would be the weird thing. We watched nothing. I remember nothing other than very wholesome shows.
Yep.
You know, like, we really did love watching Wonder Years.
My dad would
Elf.
Cry when we watched it.
Oh, it's so
and
good,
and he'd pretend
though.
Not to, because it was his exact age.
I
so
bet.
It was
yeah.
like, Kevin was my dad's age at that time. So he wouldn't want to tell us he didn't want to watch it. Because I think
right.
he wanted to watch it, but he'd make up, like, the lamest excuses. And then he'd walk in when we were watching it, and you'd see him crying. Like, yeah. But I was that age when you don't feel bad for your parents, and you just want to destroy them. Because
yeah,
that's how
yeah.
your body works, so you get out of the house. But it'd be like, are you crying? yeah, it was great. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think, like, because, like I was saying, like, my dad kind of called the shots. Like, I think my brother and I, because we only had 2 TVs in the house.
Yeah, a good TV.
Two good TVs.
Like, one would be color, and that would be the good one. And you have a black and white one?
Well, I think they were both, the basement had a black and white TV that got nothing
yeah.
on it. But the one we would have, and I'm just trying to remember this, like, in our den, maybe at that point, too, wherever we were. No, if this was our old house, I think I was 10, and we hadn't moved to the suburbs yet. But so it was just one TV. So I think my parents were like, they would let us, we played a lot.
Yeah.
We would actually listen to records and stuff like that with my dad, goof off, have snacks, hang out with my mom. Cause you know, this is when they would get to see us.
Right.
So they didn't really start letting us all rot our brains fully for about one more year. The minute Twin Peaks came onto the
yep.
air, we watched that as a family.
As a family?
As a family. And so at that point I was like 11, 12.
Yeah.
My brother, mind you, is 3 years younger. We're ruined for life.
Oh, same. I watched
we're
it. Yeah,
ruined.
Although I don't know if it's better or worse. I watched that alone at that age, like in my room alone, and then it would end at 11, and I'm like, ugh. I don't know if it'd been better if I had like a parent around to be like, yeah, no, it's okay, or like some buffer zone there.
It had to have been on at 9 in Michigan.
Yeah, it would have been because it's your central time, so it would have been
exactly. Because I'm like, there's just no world in which we stayed up till 11 at that age.
Sunday nights at 9, it was on.
Okay, that makes sense because I think it was like a little bit of a special occasion.
Yep.
you know, and it was a full hour show, and then they'd be like, right to bed, and we'd be like, but I'm terrified.
I need to talk about this.
I want to, oh no.
But they just liked it, and they wanted to watch it? Was it that kind of thing?
Well, my dad, so the thing too is, like, he's more of like a, like, he's more of a film buff, and so as much as I didn't really watch that much TV with him and my mom, like, he's the weirdo who, like, wanted to start watching David Lynch films with me and kind of indoctrinate me. Like, I saw Blue Velvet when I was probably, like, 12.
I saw it in the theater.
Like, yeah.
My dad. Not appropriate.
No, not appropriate.
No.
But I remember on a snow day, I was, ooh, good God, I was a freshman in high school, and there was a snow day, my dad had the day off, and he's like, let's go see Pulp Fiction, and... We just have this terrible history of seeing films that are far too challenging for my age, and then to also be sitting there with my dad. And like, but I paid him back in kind. Like, we did like a dad-daughter like sort of date before I left for college, and like I got to choose. And so I was like, oh, let's get Coney Dogs, you know, at the Coney Island or whatever, and let's go see Trainspotting. You know, in the theater, because I was such, like, a British freak at that point.
Yeah.
I'd gone overseas, and it was, like, Oasis and, like, EDM culture.
Yeah,
and
Brit got the whole Britpop thing,
stuff.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's, like, Scottish movie about heroin and AIDS right before your daughter leaves for college. And I didn't know it was going to go that dark. I was more obsessed with the soundtrack. And I was like, this just looks like where I want my life to be going.
Yeah.
You know? And then we just sat there, and I was like, oh, my God. Silent car ride home.
Oh, man. Have you ever talked about it after? It's just
we
never
should
happened.
Bring this up.
Yeah. Oh, we got one. Oh, you get it? Oh, yes. Yes.
Okay.
First blood. For the listener, Brooke has drawn first blood by having actually got one of the mosquitoes. And hopefully that will serve as a lesson to any others that may come into this room.
I'm getting good.
When I went to school, oh, I just got one.
Sweet.
I went to school in England for a year, and it was when Amelie came out. And I loved that movie. I saw it like three times in the theater in England. And I came back, and I was like trying to – my mom and I hadn't been talking, and I was trying to be like, oh, I should talk to my mom. So I'm like, let's go to a movie. We'll go see Amelie. And I went, and she – didn't know that there were movies that existed with subtitles and didn't understand. Because my family was like very Boston blue collar. And she was like, I didn't understand. Why were we reading the movie? And like didn't get anything. And I felt bad because I was like, I felt like I had shown up with a beret and a cigarette holder and been like, I've been to Europe.
Right.
Listen to, you know, like here's some jazz.
Right.
Yeah. And it was just like, oh, yeah. I was like, this would have been less awkward if it was just like a sex farce or some like horrible violence. Violent thing. I would have been. It would have been easier to deal with on that level. But yeah, Twin Peaks ruined so many of us as children.
So many.
Did you watch The Return?
You know what? I got about two episodes in, and I was like, I can't. I do not have the patience for this.
Yeah.
To me, it didn't seem good, and I wasn't interested. And I was like, oh, no.
I loved it, but everyone I know who's like huge Lynch fans. Hated it so much. Like Dana Gould hated it. I talked to Jane Garofalo. She went on like a 20-minute rant about how much she hated it. My friend Josh, who was like the biggest David Lynch fan I know, hated it so much after two episodes that he canceled Showtime. He stopped following David Lynch on like all social media and was just like, I'm done. Like he was so mad about it. And I just, I don't know.
And I just, like, it just went on and on and on. And I was just like,
I liked it. I think it's good, but I'd recommend it. But there's other things. There's many other. You could rewatch Leave It to Beaver. Is there anything you watch now? I mean, you don't have cable, but is there anything that you.
No, I've just personally really, really enjoyed on Amazon Prime restreaming every Unsolved Mystery.
Yeah, same here. That was my favorite.
And it is, I don't know what it says about me, that it's like a warm blanket, you know.
It is in a weird
just
way.
Just a weird, comforting Robert Stack. Well, because now there are so many updates, you know, where you're like, yeah, they got him.
Yeah,
you know?
Sometimes they didn't.
Nope, they didn't. But I do like the theory. This was one that I just loved, where they were touting the idea that Ted Kaczynski was the
Zodiac killer. Yep, that was a class. Do you know who's in the reenactment of the Zodiac killer in that?
No, maybe I...
Cole Stratton. He's when they reenact the Zodiac Killer at the picnic.
Is he really young?
He moved here to be an actor, and he's like, that was one of the gigs he got.
Oh my God. Nope. I definitely didn't notice that.
But that was such a crazy theory. But kind of makes sense.
Yeah. You're just sort of like, okay, you know, both sort of like when you think of the psychological profile of both these.
Compare the letters.
Sure. But I was just like, nah, that's not.
The ones that stick with me the most in that show. So that show I watched, Terrified.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing I would say on this show, that the weirdest thing about it was that they would put real crimes on the same level as complete bullshit. So it would be like a rapist and Bigfoot, like in the same thing. And it was like, hi, I'm very confused by this. But so many of them.
Child murders.
Yes.
And a long lost love.
Yes. And then they found money. Is it yours? And UFOs. It was like, I'm so confused. But they had so many of them took place in New England, mm-hmm. and there were places I knew. And there's one that's in the three Unsolved Mysteries stories that stick with me forever. Or there's four, actually. There's also the haunted bunk bed. If you remember that one.
I'm going to have to go look for that.
Oh, my God. I've been
loving it.
This family gets a bunk bed, and they're like, we'd go in the room, and it would be on fire. And then it was they move out of their house. And then there's one where there's a fire, and they found a videotape near the fire, and they played the actual tape. And it was this voice filming the fire going, Omar, look at the fire. And it was horrifying as a kid. And they had this theory that Omar stood for this satanic cult and whatever. But the update is it's like some 13-year-old skater kid whose friend was Omar. He's making a tape for him. But there's...
And he's like, we've got an arsonist in our hands.
Yes, Satan and arsonists that are... But they had this woman who was at a rest stop in New Hampshire. And it was a rest stop I drove by all the time as a kid. And she was pregnant. And in the middle of the night... Do you remember this one?
Wait, was she going to get a Pepsi?
Yes.
This one scared... Yeah, tell me the moment that you were like... was when she's driving to get away from him and catches up to him.
Follows her home.
Well, right, but when she's like,
oh, she sees him
so
fast. Yes.
She catches up with him on the road.
Yes.
And realizes it, has to slow down, but then he sees the house.
Yes.
After being attacked.
Stabbed seven times.
I literally, that one, because it was probably just 2 months ago that I rewatched that one, and I was like, holy shit, this is honestly the biggest fright I've had in a hot minute. And I listen to a lot of horrible things.
Yeah, and they never caught that guy. And whenever I get gigs in New Hampshire, I have to drive by the friggin' Pepsi machine. The Pepsi machine. And it's the same one.
Ooh.
It's the same one.
Oh,
and it freaks. And I'm not a pregnant woman in 1974 or whatever.
Not.
But it's still terrifying. So that one gets me. There was one about a guy who in the Boston area would go into strip malls during the day and lock the door and rape everybody.
Oh,
and like I was always in like women's clothing stores with my mom. And it was terrified. But then the one, and this was... the absolute most terrifying one, the computer one with the hammer. Do you remember this one?
No, I don't think so. There's I went back and I was like, how many seasons?
Oh, it was
like,
on forever. But there's one where this guy worked, this is like 1980 or 81, and he worked for like a computer company, which was unusual at the time. And he had an old computer he was going to sell, so he put a want ad in. And it was expensive, you know, like like 10 grand or something. Mm-hmm. So this guy's like, oh yeah, no, I'd like to buy that. And they meet at this hotel, and the guy and his wife, and they bring the computer. And the guy's like, oh great, you know, I'm like it just seemed like a legit story. So he's like, all right, I'm just going to, you know, we'll go get the cash and come back. And so they're like, great. And they're with him for a while. They come back and he's like, going to buy the computer. And then instead he ties them up and beats the woman to death with a hammer, and then thinks he beats the man to death with a hammer, but he didn't die, and then just leaves. Didn't take the money, didn't take the computer, and they never found him. And that one, for whatever reason.
Because you're like, why such preamble about computers?
Ugh.
I mean, I know everyone needs their trick to get someone into that sort of like envelope of trust, if you will, you know.
QuickBooks set him off. Oh, yeah. Those
fun.
Ones. Yeah.
Cool.
Fun stuff.
On that note, I've been canvassing.
Yes. So let's end now. Yes.
Yeah. But the note is to never go inside the house.
Don't go in the house. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Unsolved Mysteries has ruined us all. And Twin Peaks. Mm-hmm. I'd like to see someone do a parody that's an Unsolved Mysteries story about the Laura Palmer murder.
That would be
like how they would have done that at the time. Oh man, someone do that, because no one likes my ideas. Well, thank you so much for doing this. It's been great talking to you, and this was a horrifying yet warm trip down our collective past.
Yes, and I will be sending you an email about my
fantastic
blockbuster idea.
Yes, we're gonna be so rich.
Okay,
thank you. There you go. That's Brooke. Loved talking to her. Could have talked to her for hours and hours more. We survived the mutant California mosquito plague. And we may have some sort of weird disease that we don't know about yet, but that's, you know what? Check in a year. All right. Check in a year if we're all here. And then you'll know if we got weird mutant mosquito plague from our recording of TV Guidance Counselor. But thanks to Brooke for doing the show. As I said, I could have talked to her for days and weeks, although we probably would have died from dehydration. But anyway, I don't want to get grim. If you enjoyed the show, or if you didn't enjoy the show, which I presume you would not still be listening, you can go on iTunes or on Stitcher or anywhere you heard the show and rate and review it. It is a huge help for people hearing about the show. If you have a moment, it is greatly appreciated. Side note, if you've ever bought any of my stand-up comedy albums, there are two, Pilot Season and The Vanity Project Volume 1 Hollywoodland, and you want to review those, that is a huge help as well. As I said at the beginning of the show, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com. We're on all the social media, TV Guidance Counselor on Facebook, Ken Reed Comedy on Facebook, at TV Guidance on Instagram and Twitter, and at Kenneth W. Reed on both as well. That's, I think, everything. Yeah, I think that's everything. You know what? Let me check with Larry here. Yes, he's confirmed that's everything. So we'll see you again next time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Good old days when strangers could slap students in a carny tent and nobody cared.